come to order. Regular meeting of the town of Quartzsite, common council, Thursday, April 11th, 2017, is now in session. We have a volunteer to give the invocation.
Let's pray. Father, we come to you tonight so the town council can do the business for the town and of the town. Lord, we ask that you bless them, help them in their decision-making. God, we just ask that you bless the town of Quartzsite and the United States of America and the President of the United States. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Will the clerk please call the roll?
Mayor Simpson.
Here.
Vice Mayor Warner.
Here.
Councilmember Shu. Councilmember Bearcat.
Present.
Councilmember Kincaid.
Here.
Councilmember Davidson.
Here.
Presentations, reports, and proclamations. Item one, Ironwood Trees. High Jolly Cemetery Board Member D. Sheehan to provide an overview of the plight of the Ironwood Trees in Quartzsite.
I am D. Sheehan, and I'm very concerned about the Ironwood Trees that are in the gullies. All our town sits right over the washes, and the Ironwood Trees are there. And many, many of them are over 1,000 years old. And they're being cut down and destroyed. I know of three myself. I had a volunteer Ironwood Tree. It was only as thick as my finger. And it came up as a volunteer. That's 12 years. Takes them a long time to grow. And those trees out in our washes were here before this country was America. So I'd like to see something done to preserve them. What other town sits on a wash with all these beautiful ironwood trees, which will be blooming purple probably in about 2 weeks? And Lynn was going to speak here too, but she's traveling. She couldn't get here, I guess. So I just want to get it on the agenda so you're thinking about it. And when I get any smarter about it, I'll tell you. Okay, that's it.
Thank you, Steve. Item two, National League of Cities Service Line Morning Program Offer, as presented by Ashley Jaworski of Utility Service Partners Incorporated.
Address the public policy issue of our aging infrastructure. We know the community
communities all across the U.S. really have been doing their part to either upgrade or maintain their public infrastructure, but the homeowners' portion of these lines were kind of being forgotten about. So that's actually why the National League of Cities went out and did research. They wanted to make a program like ours readily and easily available to cities and towns all across the United States. So they went out, did the research on your behalf, and we were the company that they did choose to provide these programs. So what we actually do is we would partner with the town in order to make our completely voluntary program available to your residents. And we provide homeowners with optional protection on their external water lines, external sewer lines, as well as in-home plumbing. And we provide our services at a complete turnkey approach for the town, where we handle all of the aspects of the program: the marketing, billing, claims management, and customer service. And there is absolutely no cost for the town if you choose to participate in the program, and the town can actually receive an incremental revenue stream for participating as well. What I always find to be the biggest benefit of our program is that it really just helps to raise awareness. Pretty much every community that I speak with, I hear the same type of thing, that if a homeowner has some sort of issue with one of their external lines, most of the time their first call is to someone here at the town. And then you all go out to actually find that it's on the homeowner's portion of the line. And then that resident is left finding a reputable contractor and putting this large bill for something that they either thought may have been covered by their homeowner's insurance or by the town. Which you and I obviously know that neither of that is the case. So I always kind of think of our program as a free public awareness campaign, because all of the residents within the town would actually receive a letter in the mail. And the beginning of that letter really is just educational, where it lets homeowners know that these lines are something that they are responsible for, and that the town has partnered with us in order to introduce this voluntary program. So even if someone chooses not to enroll, at least in the future, they are well aware that this is something that they are responsible for, and the town really tried to take a proactive approach at helping to educate them on this. Also, it really can give your residents peace of mind, because they know for just a few dollars a month, if they choose, they're able to transfer the risk of these lines onto us, a reputable company that's not only endorsed by the National League of Cities, but also the League of Arizona Cities and Towns. And if they were to have an issue, they just give us a call 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, and we would dispatch a local licensed plumber or contractor to do the repair. So that is another huge benefit of our program, that we only have local area contractors for all of our work. We do that for many reasons, but mainly we want to keep as much money here within your local economy as possible. As well as your local contractors, we'll be familiar with the town's local codes, and we'll make sure to do the work up to your standards as well as ours, which includes getting all of the proper permits for the work as well. As for the way we actually choose our contractors, we let you as a town be as much or as little involved in that process as you would like. Once we partner with the municipality, we actually begin to develop a contractor network that would specifically service the claims within your town. And we really let you be as much or as little involved in that as you would like. Or some of our partners have provided us a list of contractors. Other ones want to stay out of it as much as possible. But with all of our contractors, we go through a detailed vetting process where we make sure that they are local, that they're licensed, that they have the proper amount of insurance, that they don't have any open complaints with the Better Business Bureau, as well as we conduct background checks and drug screenings. We just really want to make sure that it's someone that your residents are comfortable with coming to their home, as well as potentially inside of their home. As for our coverage, we offer three completely separate and voluntary programs. We offer an external water line coverage, external sewer line coverage, as well as the in-home plumbing. The two external products are set up very similarly, where we begin to cover those lines wherever they become the resident's responsibility, all the way to where they would daylight inside of the home. So if a resident were to have an issue, whether it was a broken, cracked, leaking pipe, a tree root issue, a clog that just needs cleared out, anything that impedes the flow of those lines, they give us a call and we send out one of those local licensed plumbers. And what your homeowner actually receives for their coverage is up to $4,000 towards each and every repair incident. So again, this is one of the many things that greatly separate us from other companies out there, is that ours is always on a per incident basis. So we would never have an annual or a lifetime limit, as well as we would never limit the number of incidents or claims that someone can have in a calendar year. So again, it is always up to that $4,000 towards each and every incident. But if the repair was also needed out in the public street, then they received up to an additional $4,000 for public street repair, as well as up to an additional $500 for public sidewalk repair as well. As for our third product, it is the in-home plumbing, and this one actually was kind of developed by request of our current municipal partners. It kind of was the missing piece of the puzzle. And this covers any water, sewer, or drain lines that are actually in your home after the point of entry that either could be broken or leaking. It also would include any lines that could be embedded under a slab or a basement floor, as well as the coverage for repair of clogged toilets. And that's very similar, where there's never a service fee or deductible, no annual or lifetime limits, no limit on number of claims that someone can have in a calendar year, and for the in-home, it is always up to $3,000 towards each and every repair incident. Another feature of our program is actually a revenue stream for the town. What a town receives in return for their partnership with us is actually 50 cents per month per paid warranty contract. So essentially, if a homeowner chose to enroll in all three products, the water, the sewer, as well as the in-home plumbing, then the town could receive up to $1.50 per month per household, and that is paid to you in the form of a revenue every January. A lot of our current municipal partners choose to do different things with this. Obviously, you can do anything that you like, but most commonly, it is used to help low-income residents that may be having trouble paying the utility bill from month to month. Also, I know some of our partners have used it when a resident has a leak and maybe a large water loss to try and help offset that type of cost, or some just put it back into some type of social services program as well. I know the big thing everyone always wants to know is how we market. So we only market by direct mail, so you never have to worry about us calling door-to-door, anything like that. We standardly have 3 mail campaigns per year, in the spring, the fall, and the winter. And the reason why we have 3 is because we offer 3 products. Each of our letters is geared towards 1 product at a time. And the reason why we do that is just to limit any type of confusion. We always want your residents to be well aware that these are separate products, that they do not have to choose any of them or any combination of them. So we always keep the marketing to 1 at a time, but that never deters anyone from going to our website or giving us a call and choosing whichever ones that they would like at any time. Also, with all of our marketing material, we would never send anything out to your residents unless we had your review and approval prior. We always want you to have input on that message that goes out to your residents, as well as know exactly what is going to your homeowners. Even if you've approved it prior, we still send that over for that subsequent campaign. If for some reason you would not get the approval, we would never mail to your residents for that campaign. Our standard letter, the beginning again, is that educational piece, and then it is an introductory letter where the town is introducing this voluntary program, but it clearly states that we're a separate company providing this, as well as it is always completely voluntary for the homeowner. And if someone wants to enroll, they do that directly with us by either giving us a call, going to our website, or returning the bottom of the form directly to us. We know the town has enough going on, so we try to make it as easy as possible for you to implement the program. And moving forward, your really only responsibility is the review and approval of that material. And today we are now partnered with over 400 municipalities all across the United States. We do have 20 here in the state of Arizona. And I know just with our Arizona communities, we've paid out over $3 million in claims over the last 3 years. I know I've rambled on here for the last 10 minutes or so, so I'm sure you may have some specific questions for me.
Yeah. Sure. How much does it cost?
Sure. So we offer 3 programs. The external sewer line coverage is $7.75 per month. The external water line coverage is $5.75 per month. And then the in-home plumbing is $9.99. And if someone chooses to sign up and pay annually, they actually receive about a $5 per product discount, but that never locks anyone into an annual agreement. If someone wants to cancel at any time, they just give us a call and we would refund any unused premium. So it's always month to month for a resident.
How many of your current municipalities have seasonal residents like we have in Quartzsite?
I was going to say, we actually have a lot. I would say probably most comparable in Arizona might be Shobo, where they have a lot of winter residents for the skiing. What we do is we don't ask the town to provide the mailing address for us. We have a third-party company that does that based on deeds and different things like that, so we will mail to the owner's actual address based on that property. When we have rates are a little bit higher because they're not actually in the area. So if they have an issue, they like that they can make one call to us. We send out that contractor and he gets taken care of for them.
Why do you need to partner with the town?
So that's a two-part answer. Legally and technically, we do not. Because of our partnership with the National League of Cities, as well as the League of Arizona Cities and Towns, we would never market to your residents unless we did have your approval prior. Also, because of the partnership with the town, it really obviously allows us to reach a higher amount of homeowners, which in turn allows us to offer the most generous coverage where we do not offer those service fees or deductibles, no annual or lifetime limits for the lowest monthly premium possible.
Okay, in essence, you're saying then that you have access to the database of the residents of the town by partnering with the town?
We do not require that the town provides us the database of their residents. The only requirement for the town's really participation is that introductory letter where the town introduces this program to the residents. We handle all of the aspects of that letter. We just send it over to you for your review and approval.
Do we have enough supply of local contractors that could provide? You're talking local Quartzsite.
Correct. We will start within Quartzsite. If we cannot find them within here, we will expand our search a little bit further. Typically, we're able to find enough within a community. Sometimes we might have to go a little bit further, but we really try to stay as local as possible, and then we will expand out. If your town requires contractors to be licensed within the town, then we'll use that list, so we at least know that they are following, you know, the proper steps of getting the licensing within the town.
Are you the only company that provides this service? There's no other insurance company that provides this type of service?
So there are a couple, I'd say the big one would be a water utility, which is American Water. That's really our only main competitor, but they are a utility, not really just providing this type of service. We are the only one that is endorsed by your state league as well as the National League of Cities.
In answer to your question, Mayor, we do have enough for the company line to break at once. We should be fine.
I would say with a community this size, we typically like to have 2 to 3 contractors within our network. And then as more people sign up, we might add more as they go on. But standardly, that 2 to 3 is good as, you know, for the first couple mail campaigns.
I'll just make sure I understand this properly. A lot of the houses here, especially the one I live in, is not a new house. And a lot of the underground pipes I've already replaced as far as the inlet, but as far as the sewer line going to the septic tank, we're not on sewer line. And it's old, and so I guess you could consider it a pre-existing condition. And so something like that would still be covered?
We do not have any type of pre-existing condition limitation. As long as you live within the town's limits, you're eligible to enroll in the program, as long as at the time of enrollment, your line is in proper working order. But we do not go out and inspect the lines or anything like that. Because of our over 400 partners, it really allows us to offer that standard coverage with that, you know, standard pricing, because it allows us to spread the risk with overall of our customers.
It covers lines to septic as well as sewer, because a good share of our town is not on septic yet. I mean, not on sewer yet.
So our program is geared for public utilities, so sewer or water, so not well or septic. I know they're looking to add that on. They're right now in the process of developing a program for septic, but they're hoping that it will be added on by fall. As of today, it's just for public utilities. If for any reason, we really try to weed those out when we do the mailing, as well as our letter clearly states you have to be on public utility. But if for any reason someone accidentally enrolls into the program and we discover that they have septic or well, we would refund any premium that they made into the program.
And then we're working on getting people onto our sewer system.
So then there would be mailing to those folks after they get back onto the sewer system.
Yeah, so each campaign, we kind of refresh that mailing list to try and, you know, reach the most amount of residents.
Okay, this is not an action item, this is information only.
Okay, well, thank you. Thank you very much. If any of you have any questions, don't...
Let me open it up and see if anyone in the audience has any questions on this plan.
You gave us the rates for each individual, what would be for all the warranties?
It's just, they're per product, so it would just be all of those added together.
And so you're talking about homes, so does that include manufactured homes?
If they're on a permanent foundation, then yes.
Okay.
I have a question. Is there any requirements about PVC versus copper versus galvanized?
For our repairs or...
Yeah, because most everything here is in PVC.
Okay. So we go by the town's ordinance and codes, what they would like the repair to be done.
Okay, what's on PVC?
Anyone else in the audience?
So park law, they're not set on yet, not big, set tire law.
Yes, it would have to be on some type of permanent foundation.
The biggest percent of the people that are retirees could not even think of doing that insurance, even if they're on the utility.
I was going to say, actually, I would say our largest percentage of people that actually choose to enroll in the program are retirees, because they can afford a small monthly premium, but most likely can't afford that couple thousand dollar bill, you know, if they do have an issue, as well as they really like the fact that we vet our contractors and they can feel comfortable with, you know, someone that went through all of those background checks and drug screening, you know, that's the person that's coming to their home.
Are they privately owned or in trailer parks? Are you considering a trailer park that's hooked up to the town or private homes or
what? For people that are enrolling?
Yes.
So you would have to be on a permanent foundation. Oh. So most of the time, you know, trailer parks are not on a permanent foundation.
That answered my question.
Yeah, and it's always voluntary, so there's never any type of minimum participation. So even if one person thought it would help them within the community, it would be available for that one resident. The town just simply is making a program available to you that otherwise would not be, and then it's completely up to you if you choose, if it's good for you or not.
Okay, I just wanted to verify, if you took all three of these plans, it would be about $24.50 a month.
Yeah. Okay. 25.
I should be able to do that. I was a math major.
I wonder if we have a list of how many homes here would qualify, how many homes would be site built or be on a foundation where they would qualify for this plan.
I'm sure we could get that, but we normally don't store the data that way, but we could probably back that out.
If they have to be on a foundation of some sort, a very limited number of homes that would qualify. Here, I would guess 100 or two, if that many.
That is all something that is completely up to the town. We have partners as small as, I think our smallest partner has 40 people that live in the whole town, all the way up to, you know, San Diego and Atlanta. So it's really a good fit for all community shapes and sizes. You're really just, you know, making a program available to those, you know, that it does work for them. And hopefully here in the near future, we will have something available for those septic tanks as well, so.
Okay. Anyone else? Okay. Anyone back on the council? Thank you very much for your presentation.
Perfect. Thank you very much.
Can't hear you.
Okay. consider approval of the minutes of the town council work session of March 18th, 2017, and the regular meeting of March 28th, 2017. Do we have any corrections? Okay, I'll accept the motion to approve the minutes.
I make a motion that we approve the minutes of the town council work session of March 18th, 2017, and the regular meeting of March 28th, 2017.
Second. We have a motion and a second to approve the work session of March 18th and regular meeting of March 28th. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none, motion carries. Consent agenda, item of the ledger of accounts paid.
I'd like to add, according to our rules here, it says that we can add a consent item. And I'd like to add items number 10, 11, 12, and 13, because those are just reappointments. Motion to add items 10, 11, 12, and 13 to the consent agenda.
Second. Okay, we have a motion to add items 10, 11, 12, and 13 to the consent agenda. Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Those items will be added to the consent agenda along with the ledger of accounts paid. Do we have any items on the ledger of accounts paid? I'll accept a motion to approve the consent agenda, including the ledger of accounts paid and items 10 through 13. Put on the consent agenda.
I'll put the consent agenda now so it can be approved by one motion.
I make a motion to have on the consent agenda the approval of check series 14524 through, 415-71. Totaling 107573.17, and items number 10, 11, 12, and 13.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve ledger of accounts paid and items 10 through 13 on the consent agenda. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries. Under business, receive a grant and authorization for purchase of a police vehicle.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Tonight I'm requesting the authorization to accept $30,000 in funding from Arizona Auto Theft Authority. Attached in your packet, you will have the purchase for the vehicle and all the equipment required. Now, the packet that you have shows a total of $30,180. I received an update from them today, and it's going to be actually $30,300. And let me get the exact cents. Everybody, I apologize. $300.14. So we will have to, as a town, pay for $300.14 of the purchase here. So I'm asking for authorization to accept the funds of $30,000 from Arizona Auto Theft Authority and I'm asking the authority to pay the difference, which is $300.14 from the department's capital outlay budget, which we do have enough to cover that cost, if so approved by the council today.
Any questions?
I'll make a motion to approve the accepting of the grant and the outlay of capital to pay the full amount.
Second. Have a motion and a second to accept the $30,000 donation and to approve funding of the $300.14 additional out of the police department's budget. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. I appreciate your time.
Thank you for your efforts on the grants.
Yeah.
Item number six. Boards on hiatus and mandatory boards. Discussion and possible action regarding placing some non-mandatory town boards, committees, and commissions on the hiatus. Hiatus is a break or a gap. Pause in action where they wouldn't have to meet 12 months in a row or every 2 weeks.
Well, Mayor, we put this on the agenda because of the discussion we've had previously regarding the commissions and committees. We have one, as you know, that goes dark during the summer months, and that's our cemetery board. Apparently, previously, others, Brad Baldwin, did that. Over time, that's changed a little bit as to the practice, and I think it's really a matter of whether or not the council would like to see that restored as a matter of practice, so that during the summer months we're not reaching we're not experiencing the problem that we have that we can't get the quorum that we need during the summer months. And I think if we were to establish that guideline so that the commissions and boards aren't struggling during those summer months, it might be easier on them. Now, there may be a few that have some concern because of deadlines that they have in part of their process. For example, H&D considers the requests for community funds. They may have a concern about certain months being on hiatus. But if you could give us some direction, we could begin then to talk with the different boards and commissions about whether or not that would be beneficial to them and give us probably a better opportunity to fill some of these slots in addition to what we're doing tonight.
So they can always call a special meeting during those off months, correct? If they had like an H&D board, if they had something they needed to address, they could call a special meeting?
Yes, they could. Under our current guidelines, there's nothing that prevents them from doing that.
Could still meet with conference call or whatever some of the members
are. Yeah.
We have had some limited members in the past that were not year-round residents or not here, even if they were considered year-round, were not available 12 months a year. Many go on vacation anyway during summer. And so we've kind of limited ourselves on who we can get if we do not either be able to pause some of the meetings or even if we continue the meetings, allow members to leave our area for several months of the year. So that would be where I would, we're limiting the amount of talented people we have available for these
problem is when somebody wants to be on the board, but they're going to be gone for 6 months, and they aren't really a resident of the county or the town, and yet they still want to be on the board. Now, they may have really good qualifications, but according to our creation papers, they need to be a resident of Quartzsite or at least the county. And calling in just doesn't make it. There's too much going on to be able to cover in a phone call. You know, once, twice, sure. But not for 6 months in a row, or 9 months, or a year, as we've had in the past. And I just don't believe that that is a proper way to conduct business.
If we have an elected position, it's a requirement that they be citizens of the municipality, but if they're in an appointed position, that would not be a requirement that they be a resident. Is that correct?
Well, you could, for example, with respect to the municipal utilities, UN, your resolution creating that committee requires that they be a resident, but you can change that because that's purely local control. There's no statute that tells you what to do on that board, for example.
Would using a person's residency as stated for their voting rights be sufficient?
If somebody has declared their residence, say, in another state or another town, and cannot vote here, that would be good evidence that they're not a resident.
Do all of our boards require that they be residents, or is it just a certain ones, do we know?
We're not for sure on all of them. We do know, we just referred to the UAC from this evening earlier and saw that it did state resident. But as your attorney has pointed out, that's up to you as to whether or not you want to continue that practice if you have that allowance. I'm aware of some communities that do not require precisely a residency of the community itself that is within the incorporated areas. As an example, if you look at our situation, we have people that live right nearby. For example, they have their businesses here, except that they live in Rainbow Acres. There is a similar situation up in Winslow where they have a section of unincorporated that's contiguous with their town. Those people, some of them have been here in there for four generations, and they considered them part of the town. So they were allowed to serve on boards. That's something that city did and allowed. You have that same allowance. It's just a matter of whether you want to change particular resolutions that you previously passed.
Yeah. It's my belief that most of the creation papers say a resident of Quartzsite, but I think we need to relook at that and at least be a resident of the La Paz County, even in an outlying area, and still serve on the board. But there still, I think, needs to be a time limit of absence and how many times you can call in. So I think it's something we need to look at and address in the future.
Well, I really do believe that it would be a good idea to include some of the people in the outlying areas, because right now we govern the people that live here, but a lot of what we do affects them, and they have no say because they are not residents of the town of Quartzsite. So because a lot of them have businesses here, they live in Rainbow Acres or Brenda or wherever, I think it would be a good idea to be able to expand that, to get them at least on the board, because then it gets them involved in the community.
And if we look at our vendors board, who knows more about that? Vendors and what they need than the vendors, and the vendors, the majority are part-time. So maybe we should be a little more inclusive and at least provide for some
away from the agenda, that particular, I know, that particular topic of whether you're going to require residency is not the item. The item is placing some non-mandatory boards on hiatus.
Do we have anyone in the audience that wishes to speak to whether we should be able to place some of the boards on hiatus?
Greetings, Mayor and Council. Shanana Ray Golden there. As a member of the Parks Board and a very busy person during the season, it's really nice to be able to work during the summer because that's a time where we can get a lot of things accomplished and the details where we can actually slow down and think about what needs to be done. And I know we've got a lot on our plate, so maybe if you want to, you know, leave it up to each individual board. I think it's that way anyhow. They have the authority to do that, so.
Thank you.
Councilor Mayor, I'm Dan Deaton. I just wondered if this is off the table now, but I was kind of wondering if we could lay out the method for calling an emergency meeting. Maybe that's off the table now. If not, I'm wondering how that procedure worked. Emergency.
Bruce Ford, Chairman of the Cemetery Board. I've been on this board for 10 or 11 years, and what we have decided to do, and it works very well for us, is we go dark during the summer, usually June, July, August, and back in September. If there is something that needs to be done, then we do call, have the ability to call an emergency meeting. I think it's probably best to let the boards or the committees decide what they need to do, because they're the ones that are intimately involved in the operation of that particular board. We try to get as much done before we go on hiatus or go dark. But if there's someone that comes up, Denise needs something, needs our attention, then we do call an emergency session. But that's been very rare.
Thank you. Can we bring this back with more information on which of the committees or councils need to meet 12 months a year? Are there any that have that requirement? Planning and zoning, for instance, or you know,
if you should suppose planning and zoning took a hiatus for 3 months, if you should get an application for rezoning, they should come together within a reasonable time to address that application. And I will point out to this point, and I think it is germane to the agenda item. I don't know what the other resolutions say, but the one from UAC says that the committee will provide in its rules for its meetings, and that special meetings can be called by the chairman or by 3 members. So if they decide not to meet during the summer, there's a mechanism to meet if they need to, if they do need to meet.
Thank you. Take action on this item tonight. Everyone, they have information.
I'd just like to notify if they're going dark, then if they're going dark. And if they decide that's what they're going to do, then we should be notified that they're going dark.
Okay. What we want to do, how we want to do it. What?
All we need to know is, you know, if you want to allow each of the committees and boards to make the decision within the current guidelines, we don't have any problem with that at all. Some of them do stipulate every other month currently. Some of them say twice a year it varies across the board. None of those issues address the fact that I think you probably do have some folks that don't apply for the positions because they know they're not going to be here 3 months out of the year, so they feel like they're not going to be able to contribute. So they don't even apply. So that was a part of the issue that brought this topic to you.
We can go ahead and move that we allow each of the committees to make their own decisions as long as they're staying within the guidelines of their particular committee, council, commission.
I think if we were to receive direction from the through motion that we review all of the resolutions and bring back those necessary for modification to allow a hiatus, then if it's already allowed, we don't worry. If it's not, then we'll bring it back so you can modify accordingly.
Okay, so I just want to make sure I understand. You are looking for direction from us to, not a motion, just direction.
Well, motion would be fine.
Motion would be okay? Okay, that's why I wanted to make sure I understood.
Motion.
I make a motion that we direct the town staff to check out the different boards to see what their rules are as far as hiatus during any part of the year, not just summer, but any part of the year, and make sure that they are aware that they can do that within the guidelines of their board.
Just
I second that.
I have a motion and a second. Do you have that wording? I won't try to repeat it. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Health and Development Board vacancies, item 7. There's 2 vacancies. Discussion and possible action to appoint 2 of the following applicants to the Health and Development Services Board. And the list of candidates, Shanana Rain Goldenbear, Thomas Moosh, Mark Church, Robert C. Eiler, and Linda L. Eiler. On this item, do we have any of the candidates here that wish to speak? Okay, Rain.
Go ahead.
Mayor, Council, I decided to apply for this because they do direct in the transit area as well, and I have 20 plus years experience in the transportation industry, and I thought maybe I could add some wisdom or anything to the board. Thank you.
Greetings, Shanana Rain Goldenbear. I've been attending the Health and Development Board meetings since 2008, so I feel like I have a good handle on their purpose. And I also know that there's a lot that they could be doing, and I would like to add that energy to get some more things accomplished.
Thank you. Do we have any of the other candidates here? Okay, Robert Eiler.
I
name's Robert Ayler, and I'm with the Health Development Board.
Okay. These are these all new applicants, or?
They've all been received at some time recent past, but not necessarily the last 2 weeks.
Are any of these currently serving? Renewal for any of them?
None of these are renewal to my understanding.
Okay, and is Linda also applying?
Yes. Yes.
My name is Linda Allen, full-time resident of Quartzsite, have been for 4.5 years. I'm very interested in serving on this board.
Okay. Thank you. Anyone have any questions?
Can't hear you. Do you speak up?
I'd like to see Rain and Mark Church on these boards, on this board. I think both of them have some really good information that can be shared with this board. Mr. Thomas, I don't even want to say the last name, Mr. Thomas is already gone, so you know he wouldn't be able to be active until probably fall. And I think that Robert and Linda would also be very good on this board, but I see that they are also applying for the Park and Recreation Board, and I think that they would be very helpful in that work. And I don't want to overwhelm them.
Is that your motion?
Is that your motion?
I make a motion that we appoint Shanana Rain Golden Bear and Mark Church to the Health and Development Board.
Yes.
Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second to Shanana Rain Golden Bear and Mark Church on the Health and Development Board. Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. So Shanana Rain Golden Bear and Mark Church, congratulations.
Thank you.
Item 8, Park and Recreation Committee vacancy. Discussion and possible action to appoint one of the following applicants to the Park and Recreation Committee. We have the same names, Robert C. Eiler and Linda L. Eiler. Discussion.
Well, I think we ought to leave it up to them which one of them wants to be on this board.
Flip the coin. We have one vacancy right now. Who would like to serve on that the most? Okay, it's Linda.
I make a motion that we appoint Linda Eiler to the Parks and Recreation Committee.
Second. I have a motion and a second to appoint Linda Eiler to the Park and Recreation Committee. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Item 9, Planning and Zoning Commission vacancy. Discussion and possible action to appoint the only applicant, Thomas J. Mush, to the Planning and Zoning Commission. Or Municipal Utility Administrative Committee vacancy. He's applied for that position also. On Planning and Zoning, we have two vacancies, so we can appoint one now to fill a vacancy on that. We have only one.
I don't think he qualifies any of those issues because he isn't a
just reapply.
Do we know if he's a resident on vacation or?
It's our understanding that he's only here 6 months each year, is that correct?
That's my
understanding. It would appear that he doesn't meet the practice of residency, but we do not know for a fact. And with his not being present this evening, obviously we can't clarify that.
I make a motion that we table this until we have more qualified applicants.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to table item 9 until we have more applicants. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Items 10 through 13 were included in the consent agenda. Item 14, Council Procedures Resolution. Could we have it quiet in the front row there, please? We can hear you clear up here. Thank you. Council Procedures Resolution. Discussion, consideration, and possible action to adopt resolution number 17-05, changing the order of business on regular council meeting agendas. The change would call the or would place the call to the public and communication from citizens immediately after the roll call.
No, this is for announcements.
think I could find an announcement in the resolution number 1701, so I just left those out.
So I think that's an important point. If I wanted to put call the public at the very beginning, that the announcements of events and so on be also at that time.
Makes sense to me. Discussion.
Sounds good to me.
We've got some confusion over on this side of the room. There wasn't anything on the agenda tonight or in the resolution, the prior resolution, about an announcement session. You usually announce. We just don't know quite what you mean.
That can occur during the call of the public.
It doesn't have to be a separate item, in other words. It can be a part of the call to public.
It's often part of the, no, it's often part of the council report.
Well, they're talking about public announcement, not council announcements.
Call to the public. If you want a separate, I don't think it's necessary. It wasn't on this agenda, and it wasn't in the prior resolution, to have a separate item for public announcements, but it would appropriately be in call to the public.
It used to be, in the past, during talk to the public, that that was also a time a citizen could make an announcement of a party or
that's
whatever
what
was going on.
That's what we're saying.
And
it just isn't listed separately.
Could we simply add call to the public and announcements?
Yes, that's what I'm getting at.
Make it easy. Okay. So let's open it up to the public. Anyone have any discussion on moving the call to the public to the front after the roll call?
It's a good thing.
Okay, that's one. Okay, we'll close to the public.
I make a motion that we move the order of business at a regular council meeting according to resolution number 1705, so that there is the call to the public, announcements, and communications from citizens immediately after the roll call.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Carries. Item 15, Arizona Department of Housing, Office of Manufactured Housing, IGA. That's an agreement, a governmental agreement with the Arizona Department of Housing, Office of Manufactured Housing, to enforce installation standards. And who's presenting this?
I will be. Mayor, council members, in the past, the town has had an agreement with what was previously called the Department of Manufactured Housing. It's now an office within the Department of Arizona, or the Arizona Department of Housing, it's called. They have provided the service of reviewing all applications for installation of mobile homes. There's special requirements regarding that. They specialize in it. They do it throughout the state. They simply review an application to ensure that a home, a manufactured home, mobile home, is being installed according to manufacturer standards. It relieves the requirement then for the town to have to be reviewing all of those. And as I say, we've had an agreement with them in the past. We recommend that we continue with that agreement. It's much more efficient for us to do that rather than try to keep up with all the standards ourselves.
Discussion.
It's better to have an agreement with somebody that has the staff to do this and knows what the rules are and can keep up with the rules rather than trying to overburden our staff with trying to keep up with all of this.
What's the turnaround time? department, do they have...
Generally, it's been around 2 to 3 weeks.
Oh, okay.
End result of this is occupancy permit. Everybody has to do that inspection, make sure there's a maintenance proper code. There's generally state rules and regulations as well as local codes. So that has to all be inspected and certified to get an occupancy permit for the setting of a new manufactured home.
Mayor, council members, you know, we're reviewing this document a little bit closer, and we're a little concerned that it's not written by the same standards as the previous one. And we think perhaps we just need to table this so that we can clear this up with the office of manufactured housing.
I make a motion that we table item number 15 until the town manager and the attorney have an opportunity to review the documentation.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Item 16, selection of the PACE Advanced Water Engineering Firm for on-call engineering services. Discussion of possible action to select PACE Advanced Water Engineering Firm for on-call engineering services related to water and wastewater projects and to authorize the town manager to negotiate with PACE to be engineer of record on the current wastewater treatment plant renovation and related collection systems improvements.
Mayor and council members, the staff has been reviewing a number of submittals for on-call engineers. We received 8 initially. We narrowed it down to 5. Out of that 5, we interviewed all of those 5, I should say. Out of that, we found that PACE Engineering was the one with the greatest amount of experience and specialized in water and wastewater. In that our review process stated clearly that we would establish a list for on-call that could include as many as 3 or so. We still are determining which of the remaining 4 might be on the on-call list for other purposes, but we believe the PACE Engineering clearly meets the criteria that we've set for water and wastewater projects. We would ask that they be accepted as the on-call engineer for that purpose and allow us to begin negotiations with them on a contract to proceed with the as engineers of record for the wastewater treatment plant renovations. The reason we ask for both of those to be done tonight is that USDA has advised us that they need to know immediately who is being established as the engineer for that purpose. And so we would like to move ahead with the PACE Engineering at this time for both the list for on-call as well as the engineer record for the wastewater treatment plant design and the collection system portion as well.
And that was the people that did the presentation here recently?
Yes, that's the firm that you've been introduced to. They're the ones that conducted the work session, which included the tour out of the plant. We've had quite a bit of experience with them, and we believe in comparing them to the other firms that they clearly have the greatest expertise in wastewater, and we should proceed with them.
Being on call and engineer of company of record, do they receive any kind of retainer?
No.
Or?
No, they will only be paid when we engage them in a specific project. On-call list will allow us to pick any of those firms for any given project. We will complete, as I say, the process. We're doing some additional reference checks, probably is the best way to say it, with the other firms before we make the final selection on the other on-call engineering firms. but their PACE engineering stood out so greatly from, in terms of water, wastewater, that we felt we should proceed with them.
And how many did you anticipate being on the list for on-call?
We think we'll probably end up with 3 total, so probably 2 more. The other 2 will probably be a little more, have a little bit broader experience in various types of municipal projects.
Council, anyone else? Discussion? Open it up. Anyone in the audience?
Mayor and Councilman Dan Heaton. So the 8 that were considered to be for on-call, they got that went down to 5.
Correct. That's correct.
And so the 5 that are remaining are not the ones that are going to be considered for negotiation for the being on the record. Is that correct?
No. Out of the 5, one of them was PACE Engineering. Right. PACE Engineering had the broadest experience and more specific experience in water and wastewater. The other 4 have experience in a lot of other areas, streets and pathways and parks and many other civil engineering projects.
So PACE is the front runner?
Only for water and wastewater.
Okay. And who was the entity that wanted to indicate that this decision had to be made, and that decision being the engineering firm to be on record and that you're going to negotiate with? Who decided that?
That's the USDA Rural Development Office.
USCA?
Yes, Rural Development.
It's USDA.
USDA.
DA.
US,
yes. Rural Development.
And they told you that they wanted this decision to be made. In other words, it seemed to me like the remaining 5, which includes PACE, might also be considered for your negotiations with the being the engineer of record for the whole project. Now, because of the hurriedness of it, they're not going to be considered for that. Is that a fact?
For that specific project, those other 4 would not be considered at this time. That's correct.
And
they'd be considered for other projects.
And so you firmly believe that this USDA requirement for this thing to be rushed through, hurry, hurry, let's go, is bona fide?
This project's been going on for 5 years. I don't think this is a rush. USDA, frankly, has made it very clear, including in a letter to the community, that they need a decision or the money's probably going to go back to Washington.
Well, that's what I asked, and that's what you're answering.
Yeah.
And so, obviously, PACE has the front-runner position because they've given the tours and the presentation relative to what they want to do. I just want to make sure that 5 years or not, we don't need to rush it in 1 week. In other words, you know, if we can get the best engineering firm, that would be the reason. That's why I'm making my comments. Another reason why I'm making these comments is the MUAC board has not been apprised of this whatsoever. And we had a meeting that was canceled last month due to quorum problems. So that's why I'm up here asking these questions right now.
Anyone else in the audience wish to speak on this? Okay, back to Councilor's pleasure. This is an action item.
Make a motion that we accept and go PACE. Authorize town manager to negotiate with PACE to be the engineer of record for wastewater and water. And the on-call.
And be on call.
Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. And just, do you have the wording on that?
Yes.
All those
March, I believe, of last year, we agreed to lease the space that we previously used for children's library, I believe it was, and that was with Eve's place. And something happened in the process, and the lease was never completed. Nevertheless, they've been a very good tenant for the last year. When it was initially set up, the understanding was that they would have a lease that provided them with a space that would have an in-kind value of $24,000, $2,000 a month, which works for them in terms of the funding that they receive. Actually, a $1, you know, a year they would pay, but the in-kind was $24,000. There was no requirements for them to pay for utilities, except they were supposed to hook up a meter for the electric and to take care of that. There was also not a clarification on the actual maintenance of the facility. So this came to my attention when the water heater apparently went out. And so I asked for a copy of the lease. And found out we had one, but it just had never been signed. So we started the process of finding a way to make this better for both parties. And we found that a few changes made a lot of sense. One is that the facility itself is a small building and has minimal upkeep needs. We would like to maintain that building ourselves so that in the future, if we wish to use it again for our own purposes, we know that it has been properly maintained. But we can't afford to do that if we receive no income from the lease. So the agreement that was made that is before you this evening is that we would continue to have a $24,000 a year in-kind contribution of the facility, but the Eve's Place will pay us for the utilities. We will go ahead and take care of the issues regarding the maintenance of the facility, but they will pay us $800 a month. That $800 a month then is credited toward the utilities, and any reserve would be used for any of the improvements that we might need to make. We believe it's a win-win for both parties. There was one add-on, and that is they wanted four parking spaces in front so that their staff has a place to park when they're there. We also added one clarification in the last copy that you received, and I want to point that out to you. There was some concern because of earlier drafts that the facility might be used as a shelter. That is not the intent, or has it been used as a shelter by Eve's Place to date. So in 5.1, section 5.1, you'll note that the following verbiage has been entered. In fact, let me just read 5.1. Tenant shall use the lease premises solely to provide the victim services program thereon. Then we inserted, during the lease between the town of Quartzsite and Eve's Place, the lease premises will not be used for a domestic shelter or child care facility. It goes on that town makes no representation or warning with respect to the condition of the lease premises or its fitness or availability for any particular uses. So that language regarding the usage as a domestic shelter and child care facility was to clarify that it was not intended to be used for that purpose. It shall not be used for that purpose. That's the main change that you see in the last copy that you received tonight. Also, in terms of the commencement of the term, it was agreed that this would commence on March 1, and so it would be retroactive to March 1.
Any discussion from council? I'll open this up to the public. I don't know how much information the public has on this item.
our children's recreation building located at 465 North Plymouth Avenue with Eve's Place.
Second that.
Have a motion and second to approve the lease of town property with Eve's Place. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Item 18, council member alternate designated check signer. We lost one of our check signers, and we needed an alternate. Anyone have an additional interest? Your check signer?
I nominate Star Fairfax to be the alternate check, and alternate check signer.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Have a motion and a second to designate Star Fairfax as our alternate check signer. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Abstentions? Motion carries. Item 19, possible purchase of express bill paid for the town's business license renewal applicants, business license applicants, and vendor permit applicants. Consider authorization for the town manager to enter into a contract with express bill pays non-utility online payment options for business license renewal applicants, business license applicants, and vendor permit applicants, allowing for application, processing, and payments.
Yes, I'm the one that asked to put this on the agenda. I believe that it would be very beneficial to our business owners and our vendors that they would be able to use the internet to make their payments. Instead, right now, the only payments that we can make to the town are the utility payments. And what this would do would allow us to open that up so that the business owners, whose licenses are all going to be due on July 1st, many of them are going to be out of town. They're gone for the summer. This way, they can keep their businesses active and get their licenses up to date on time, and not have to worry about trying to hunt them down throughout the country, wherever they are. They all know that their licenses are due on July 1st, although I'm sure we're going to remind them, because this is only the second year that that's happened, so I'm sure there will be a reminder system. But it would be very nice to be able to say in that reminder letter that they can now use the internet to pay for their licenses. The same thing with the vendors. If we open this up and have a separate module for the vendors, then the vendors can put in their licenses in the summertime, or they're getting their licenses early, then they can negotiate with the people that are the showground folks to find out where they're going to be. And I think it's important that we allow them to do this. Everybody is using the internet to make these kinds of payments, and I think that the town of Quartzsite is kind of falling behind in that regard. My understanding of this express bill pay is the modules to do this, the licensing for the business and the vendor license permits and so forth, they're $500 a piece for each module. However, you can buy 10 of these modules for $1,500. So, in my opinion, it is better to buy all 10 modules instead of just two or three. And the reason is because during a tour of Celia's garden, it came to me that we could use one of these modules for donations to Celia's garden. We could use one of them for the Historical Society. So there's other things that we can use these modules for besides just business licenses and utilities. So that was why I encourage us to purchase the 10 modules. We may not use them all right now, but if we're using four or five or six of them, we're already ahead of the game because they're $500 a piece if you buy them one at a time. So if we buy the 10 at 1500, we still have some that we can come up with some creative thinking about what we might do with the ones that are remaining. The one question that I don't know the answer to yet is if something, one of those modules becomes obsolete, say we did it for some kind of community activity, because what they were showing in the documentation I had was they were having like a rodeo or something, and they were having people buy into the rodeo thing. That was one of the things that they had. What I don't know is if that module becomes obsolete, if you can then use it for something else. I don't have the answer to that yet. That's one question that I have yet to do. But the rest of the questions that I had were all answered very satisfactorily. And I would like to see this in place so that at least our business owners who have to renew by July 1st have the ability to get in. I think that should be the very first module that we implement, and then the vendor business renewal and the vendors second, and then new licensing for businesses maybe third, and then bring in the Historical Society and Celia's Garden as, you know, shortly thereafter.
I see problems currently for the vendors when you want to secure some vendor area, you're required to have your permit from the town ahead of time, and I understand it's first come, first serve. How can someone out of town, if they're not here to get their town license, be able to secure a vendor? Dennis, could you answer that possibly?
Not at all. But I do have it.
No, Mark is jumping up there. Let Mark jump in.
I handled the vendor's permits last year. They can apply to the mail, get their vendor's license, and then the venue, wherever they're selling at, can tell them what spaces they need. But, you know, we can't issue that license until they have a space number. But if, you know, there's a three-way conversation there between the venue, the person getting the license, and the town, and we can find out space number real easy and then get that on the vendor permit and get it back up to them up north.
Thank you. Dennis?
I'll tell you, 24 is a rough age. My name's Dennis Gill, Mayor and Council, Town Manager. Where we are, the spaces are assigned upon receiving their application. So they already have a space when they fill out an application for Desert Gardens. Well, my question to you would be, if they pay online, obviously they'll have a receipt. Well, can that receipt be used in place of a permit? The reason being, what are we really gaining?
You're right.
Oh, thank you.
Well, the only thing with the permit is, do they have, because I don't know the answer to this, do they have to display the permit in their space?
It has to be displayed in the space. My thinking is that they have a permit and if they have a receipt that they paid, why would they need a permit? Why would someone have to come around and just about go through the whole process? Now, also, if they're going to pay online, do they have to fill out an application, you know, a vendor permit application? Or could that not be included on the module?
That's the intent. That's my understanding, is they have to fill out the information before they make the payment.
And we designed the module the way that we wanted.
So if you put a little seal on here, as you do with...
And then they can, you know, they can print it out, or we can send them a copy or whatever.
Well, if they can print it out, you know, you're saving your mailing expense plus the time and hours. It's already there. Something to ponder.
Yeah.
That's a great idea.
We need to know a little bit more about how the design works. Because, you know, of course they gave you information in here about the ones that were already designed. But
we need to know a little bit more about how the design works, but I think that it's at least something that we ought to look into fairly quickly, because you've got business licenses that were renewals that are all coming up in July, and I'd like to see at least that one in place. That would give us something to work with, to practice on.
That would save you so much time, energy, headaches.
Well, the other thing is that I'm hopeful that in doing that, that the response from the town as far as getting the business owners their licenses will be a little better. Last year, one of my clients, it was 6 weeks after she paid before she got her license. And for me, it was 4 weeks. You know, and that's not acceptable as far as I'm concerned. That's just way too long. So I'm hoping that since they're all due now at the same time and that licensing procedure seems to be kind of an issue, that by doing this online, we have more people that get it done in a timely manner so that we can get the licenses out in a timely manner.
Sure. Excellent idea. Mm-hmm. All those in favor?
Hi, Gary. Good to see you.
Dave Collier, my only question is food vendors have to have health permit and the fire department permit before they can even buy a town permit. So like, you can't do that online. They have to physically be here to get inspected. So you can't promise a food vendor you can sell them a vendor permit online, because they'll come to town and say, I got my permit, I can open it up no matter what. And that's the way they'll use it. After 30 years of dealing with these vendors myself, I can tell you they'll try every little trick to get a vendor permit and open up.
I was not aware that there was also extra requirements, but I still think that there are a lot of other vendors that could use it.
Well, sure, there probably is, but what I'm saying is you guys are going to have to segregate the food vendors out of it.
If they're called Good Eats, we know that they shouldn't get one of those kind of licenses.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Council Dandy, is the... One of the modules now, would that be the utilities out of the 10?
No, the utilities are already set up. This is another extra 10 on top of the utility.
Is there any way to incorporate that into the 10? I mean, is it spread bill pay?
No, it's already in place. We don't need to incorporate it.
Okay, just one other thing then, the sales tax is collected by express bill pay for utilities, bill pay. Is there any sales tax on these?
No.
All right.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, then we'll close the public comment and we'll come back to the council. Any last questions? What's your pleasure?
I make a motion that we authorize the town manager to enter into a contract with Express Bill Pay, the non-utility online payment option for the 10 modules that they have available to us for $1,500. I'll second that.
I have a motion in a second. The town manager enter an agreement to get the Express Bill Pay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Okay, next item. Move a motion to adjourn to executive session.
Make a motion to adjourn to executive session. Second.
A motion and second to adjourn to executive session. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Mayor Simpson.
Here.
Vice Mayor Warner.
Here.
Councilmember Shue. Councilmember Bearcat. Councilmember Kincaid.
Here.
Councilmember Davidson.
Item 21, Colorado River Water Allocation, has been tabled and will return on our next council meeting with additional information that we'll be able to review. Under communications report from the mayor on the current events, I have no report tonight.
there was a lot of things that were said there that indicate to me that Joanne and Paul both are getting to the point where it's very difficult for them to take care of that property. And at some point in fairly near future, that we as a town may have to step up and start doing, which is one of the reasons that I encouraged that express bill pay because of the donations. Because my understanding is that Joanne and Paul have basically taken on and paid for everything that has been done in that park pretty much on their own. I think there has been a little bit of town support, but not very much. And that's partly due because they've never asked for it. And I made that very clear to her that they needed to ask for some help from the town, that we can't just give it to her, that she has to ask for it. But I think that at some point we may have to do a little more than just that and take some responsibility for the property that is actually ours. It belongs to the BLM. My understanding is it belongs to the BLM. We as a town lease it, but we have given her permission to put the Celia's Garden in there. So technically the property belongs to us, and I think it's at some point fairly soon that we maybe need to take over some responsibility for the maintenance of it.
Anyone else? Council members? Seeing none, the report from the town manager.
Mayor and council members, I just thought this was kind of interesting. We always wonder sometimes what our state officers do for us. And received a little letter from the Attorney General's office noting that they had filed a suit on behalf of state agencies and political subdivisions concerning damages for state agencies and subdivisions that pay more than they should have for computers and other electronic equipment. And apparently they got a settlement, and they sent us a check for $99.25. We got something from all that work. We cashed it immediately. I really have nothing. I put this in just in case.
Okay, let's move on to call to the public and communications from citizens.
There's nobody here now. Marilyn McFaith. I want to remind everybody the Women's Club has a blood drive the Monday the 24th at 9 until 1 o'clock. So if you can donate blood, it would be appreciated. I'd like to say something about the food bank. I've been working with food in Quartzsite for over 30-some years. And I asked Carol about 20 years ago to help me, so she was a good friend, and I will miss her. But we're running the food bank very well with volunteers. There's always been volunteers. Not one person ever received money, wages or anything. Except the county did give Carol the last 2 years a stipend of some kind. I didn't ask her, I didn't say it. But Carol told me that they gave her donations that was received in Quartzsite to the food bank, county food bank donation. And it amounts to a big lot of money, and we were hoping that somebody on the council would, since we're all volunteers and trying to take care of stuff, would look into the fact that there was a large sum of money that was turned in from Snowbirds and others to the food bank, county food bank accounts. And since the county is scrounging for money, we may have lost that, and we'll need the money to buy peanut butter or whatever is necessary to hand out this summer. And as far as I know, we have a young man named Jason Moore that stepped up to take Carol's part that she was doing. We have another lady that's doing computer work in the other room too. So there, we've got everything covered that was covered before. But there was a lady from Salome last Thursday that came in, and she said, "I'm your supervisor." To me, she didn't say it to the others. And I don't know if she did it on her own, or if the county has appointed someone, or whatever. But since Quartzsite has two supervisors here, Deuce Miner and Holly Irwin, and Holly's been working with the food bank, we feel like, or I personally feel like, that we have been self-sufficient from at least 30, 40 years providing food here in Quartzsite on our own, working with St. Mary's Food Bank and other entities, whether it was the Blythe Church or whatever. Through the years, we've kept food delivered to Quartzsite. And if the county is so poor, maybe the town could consider buying the building and the land and putting in the water and sewer, whatever's necessary. I don't know. We were just talking about something of that sort and be our own entity again. But is there any of you council person that could go to the supervisors meeting and find out if we still have money to buy things this summer?
I don't know if how that's situated. Is there a separate bank account for the food bank that would? All I'm familiar with is the Friends of the Food Bank.
No.
This isn't on the agenda for discussion, but I think you can ask
the manager. Can I answer that? That's the reason that Carol and everyone else. I have observed hauling bread and stuff back and forth. Whatever was delivered and given in Parker stayed in Parker. I got the load of bread to bring to the food bank in Quartzsite. And so we got to thinking maybe we should take care of things ourselves in the Friends of the Food Bank. Richard Trustee's wife, Lois, said she'd incorporate. And that way the county wouldn't be getting into all our own. I recycle the bottles and cans and stuff, have for years. It only brings in $3-4, maybe 20, but it still buys peanut butter or bread or whatever. So the Friends of the Food Bank was formed to take care of donations that snowbirds gave, clubs like the Rock Club and others donated to.
Okay.
And that's separate.
Thank you. Okay, can we get the staff to look into
Mayor, we will inquire as to what the current status is and what the future opportunities are.
Thank you.
Hi, Shanana Ray, Golden Bear. You might want to look into the 2014. There was a meeting with the Food Bank Board. I don't know what it's called, but it's at the county level. And there wasn't accounting of all the funds up until that time. So I do know that part.
So there was an audit?
Yes, there was an audit, and it was delivered to the board, and you might even, the agenda, the minutes, there is a report that was delivered to the board, and it was in the summer of 2014. Wearing my other hat, I want to remind folks that Saturday is the Easter egg hunt, and that's going to be at the town park, 9 o'clock sharp. Be there early, and we have gotten some great donations, so we will be getting all the goodies tomorrow and putting the eggs together and getting out there and getting it done. So come on down, enjoy our kids, because it's always fun to watch. And it'll be over very quickly.
Thank you.
And Eden Council. Relative to the highway work that was discussed in the last town council meeting, a lot of folks seem to think that, you know, maybe that there's better ways to $2 million, part of the $12 million for the work on 17, and, you know, a lot of different ideas. So it got me to wondering whether it's possible to have the town have some kind of coordination with our, first of all, our county supervisors, and most importantly, a person like Gosar, who's our state, who's our representative, and also get our state representatives. Is there a way that is legal, and is there a way that is efficient to be able to contact those people with our concerns, like have start a focus group or political action committee or something like that? Because all the times that I've spent down here when in the council meetings, I've never heard any of our elected officials, except when they're running, come down here and even, you know, have an interest in what's happening in Quartzsite. So I thought maybe that if we could look into something like that, maybe it would be to our advantage.
I'm not sure what direction to take from that, Mary. Are we talking in terms of the staff looking into a political group to challenge some of these other governmental movements, or are we talking specifically?
Yeah, to my knowledge, was done several times in the past. We have done so in the past before they made a determination how they were going to do it. They were going to put a roundabout and several different things, and other access roads, even on the north side of 17. So at this point, I don't know if this is pretty much budgeted and in process now. I don't know how we can do anything, but that's what we could direct you to look into it and see.
We're going to be bringing you an updated report at your next meeting. They did have a meeting concerning their schedule, but they only determined 2 weeks worth, and so there's really nothing to report on that. But at your next meeting, I think we'll have a better schedule from them, but outside of that, I'm not sure what direction you want us to follow.
Look into it and see.
Yeah, it'll be on the next agenda.
Okay. And no further call to the public. We'll close that. Move on to future agenda items.
Several items that we've tabled previously, and we might bring one or two of those forward, depending upon how busy the next agenda begins to look. We certainly will be scheduling a meeting for our next budget review, and we had looked at somewhere around the 18th, 19th, I believe. It appears that now might meet everybody's needs and schedules, so we're not sure about.
He will be gone.
And did he say for 3 days?
He'll be back that Friday.
We might want to look the next week then. Now, I did have a request that we try to do that work session back to back with the regular council meeting. Is there a preference on that? Like, for example, we'd have the budget session separate from the council meeting with the same amount. Is there a preference on that?
I'm not sure. The last time that we did that, we ended up getting so rushed into it that the budget went through, and it, you know, I wasn't real comfortable with the whole thing. I prefer to have it on a separate time so that we don't have to rush to meet the deadline at 7 o'clock for a regular council meeting.
That's clearly my preference, for the same reason. I want to make sure that our budget meetings that we have all the time necessary. I want any time to take into consideration a recommendation that at least one of the council members have made in taking your time in consideration.
Well, I would rather spend the time, extra time. I mean, if it takes us a half an hour, great. But if it takes 3 hours and we've only allocated two, then we either have to put it off or we have to rush into something, and I don't like either one of those options. I'd rather see it on a separate day.
Same here.
Rather have it on a separate day and time. Oops, that's all. I should push my button. I'd rather have it on a separate day and time. And take each department individually so that we can thoroughly go into their budget and their needs rather than looking it up, you know, to the side and sandbagging it, hence the term have become.
That's our intent.
Okay, I agree. That's
okay.
Then on a separate day.
We'll get you a schedule.
Okay,